It's good of you, this. We continue our discussion on just hold on, hold on. Okay. Okay, good afternoon. Let us continue. We were discussing about signal generators, signal generation using op-amps. That is, we discussed triangular and rectangular waveform generation. So from that, we also discussed sawtooth and square waveform. Okay, is this the screen not shared? Okay. Okay, fine. Here we go. Okay, yes, now last class we discussed this, the oscillator, that is the RC phase shift oscillator. So in this case, in this case, we we understood that once the Barkhausen criteria is satisfied, the oscillator will automatically start oscillating. It starts generating the oscillation. Because we are using the inverting amplifier here, the output what we get is a noted version. I mean, see, first of all, there is no input. If you see this circuit, other than this DC voltage what we are applying, there is no input as it is. But because of the nature of the op-amp output starts oscillating whenever this differential voltage is generated. Okay, then even if this differential voltage is very small, even if it is equal to, it is a 0.1 volt, even if it is less than that, the oscillator will start this op-amp starts oscillating. And by using this RC combination, three set of RNC combination, we can generate a oscillation when two of the Barkhausen criteria are satisfied. That is, when A beta is greater than or equal to 1, and the second condition is when total phase shift of the entire network, complete closed loop network, if it is equal to 0 degree or 360 degree. Just a second, somebody is on the line. Okay, when it is equal to 0 degree or let us say 360 degree. Okay. Now, in another condition is that whatever the output is generating, we have to control this, because in the signal generator, if you remember in ABC lab, we had one function generator or signal generator, okay? In that, there are two knobs, one for the frequency adjustment, okay? One for the frequency adjustment, another is for the, what you call, the amplitude adjustment, okay? Now, what is this amplitude adjustment? Is that, you know, it is used to adjust the amplitude level. For a given frequency, it will adjust the amplitude. That means it is a amplitude stabilization process. You know, that means we are going to adjust the amplitude in such a way that, you know, the amplitude can be adjusted. That means it can be adjusted for a required level. Okay. Okay. So here we go. Okay. So that we'll discuss now. That is amplitude stabilization of oscillators. That is how to control the output voltage level of the oscillatory circuits. Okay. Fine. So let us look into this. I'm not able to get this. Here. So output amplitude of an oscillator tends to be maximum possible output voltage the amplifier can produce. Okay, so as we discussed, you know, the resistor. Okay. Anyway, so output of the oscillator, it starts oscillating. Okay, so oscillating means it will oscillate between the two voltages. Okay, positive and negative voltages. These voltages are almost equal to this biasing voltage. Okay, of course, 1 volt less than the biasing voltage. For example, plus VCC minus 1, and this will be minus VE plus 1. Okay, so because of this, there's no control. See, if a general oscillator is considered, if you have seen in crystal oscillator experiment, you know, in ADC lab, okay, so output was continuously oscillating. We don't have any control over the oscillations. Okay, so thereby, by modifying this circuit, we can implement the oscillatory stabilization network or circuit. So waveform is also likely to be distorted to some extent because it is limited only by the amplifier saturation voltage. Okay, that means output is limited only by the amplifier saturation voltage. So if this is let us say, for example, VCC is 15 volts. VCC and VE, of course, plus VCC, plus or minus VCC, if it is 15 volts, so the saturation will be close to 14 volts, okay, close to plus 14 volts and minus 14 volts. So it is limited by the supply voltage, that is biasing voltage. So to minimize the distortion and to reduce the output amplitude to an acceptable level, amplitude stabilization circuitry must be employed. Okay, that means to limit this voltage. To limit this voltage to the required level, okay, so we have to go for a what is known as a amplitude stabilization circuit, and moreover, we have to stabilize this voltage, you know, we have to control this voltage, otherwise it will continue to oscillate and it will be distorted. It is on the line. It is, I think it is automatically admit, maybe. Okay, yeah. Okay, it's fine. So so for these requirements, okay. So amplitude stabilization operates by ensuring that oscillation is not sustained if the output exceeds some predetermined level. Okay, that means amplitude, that oscillation is controlled. Oscillation is not sustained when output reaches some level. Okay, so when it reaches that level, output oscillations is minimized. Okay, so for oscillatory circuit discussed, previous class, we discussed like RC phase shift oscillator or Wien bridge oscillators. Okay, amplifier gain must always exceed 29 to sustain oscillations. Last class we discussed, in the last class we had a detailed discussion on this, that in this case the amplifier will generate the feedback. I want to fit this picture to the display. Something like this. Okay, so one of the conditions for the stabilization is A beta should be greater than or equal to 1. If the beta is around 29, okay, sorry, this is beta is, if it is 1 by 29, then A should be at least 29, at least 29, so that A beta will be greater than or equal to 1. Okay, so then 29 into 1 by 29, so it will be around 1. So A should be at least greater than 29, so that stabilization is oscillation is sustained. Okay, so our ultimate intention is to generate the oscillations, but this oscillations should be stabilized, you know, so that control, so that we can get a varied output voltage. Okay, so this, in this case, the A should be greater than or equal to, at least it should be at least equal to 29 to start with, but it should be slightly greater than 29 so that this condition is satisfied. That derivation case I'll discuss some possibly in the next class. I have not scanned the pages, you know, the derivation of this, you know, this formula. So last class we saw this, you know, derivation of the, we saw this equations. So derivation is given in the appendix, so I'll possibly I'll show it in the next class. Okay, so there we'll understand how this equations are derived and why this 29 is is the gain of the amplifier, minimum gain of the amplifier to sustain the oscillations. So that we'll discuss later. So and then the inverting amplifier in the phase shift oscillator. Okay, so here R2. Okay, so in this case, what we discussed in this case, R2. What is resistor R2? Is there is the feedback resistor for the amplifier, which will decide the gain, because it's an inverting amplifier. The gain of the inverting amplifier is minus R2 by R1. Okay, so this minus R2 by R1 should be such that this should be greater than at least 29, or should be equal to, at least should be greater than or equal to 29, to be more clear, to be more precise, to sustain the oscillations. So thereby, what is, yeah, somewhere here. Okay, so here the R2 is bypassed with diodes. A part of R2, not complete R2, a part of R2 is bypassed, you know, it is bypassed using diodes. When the output amplitude is low, none of the diode is forward biased, and they have no effect on the circuit. Okay, so let us jump to the circuit, you know. We'll discuss with by looking into the circuit. Okay, this single resistor R2 is now divided into two resistors, R3 and R4. Okay, now this R3 and R4 are such that a part of R2, that is R3, is bypassed by the diodes pair D1, D2 and D3, D4. Okay, we have two pairs, D1, D2 and D3, D4, D4, such that a part of this R3 is bypassed, so that the gain of the amplifier, okay, guess what is the gain of this amplifier is, since it is an inverting amplifier, the gain is minus R2 by R1. If R2 is not bypassed, that is, if complete R2 is used, the gain will be greater than or equal to 29. That should be the design, okay? If R2 is reduced, what happens to the gain? Gain decreases. When gain decreases, output amplitude decreases. But how to bypass the part of this R2? For that, we make use of the two pair of resistors, D1, D2 and D3, D4. Why two pair of resistors are required? Diodes. Okay, why the diodes are required? Okay, let us say, for example, if the output of this feedback network, if it is positive, during positive cycle, what will happen is, diode D1 and D2 are forward biased, and hence the path for the current will be, there is path for the I2 current will be like this, from through D1, D2, R4 and output. When R3 is bypassed, the gain of the amplifier is minus R4 divided by R1. Okay, and R4, since it is less than R2, the gain with R4, gain with R4 is less than gain with R2. Very simple. It's quite straightforward. Okay, so we're reducing R2. The ultimate intention is to reduce the value of R2. The question here is, we could have used only R4 instead of R3. Not that will not help in stabilizing, you know, we should be able to adjust this R3 and R4 in such a way that we can obtain the required value of resist, required value of gain of the amplifier. Okay, yeah. So thereby, that is for the positive, cycle. That is for the positive. What about for the negative cycle? Is negative cycle, this D3 D4 is forward biased. The current flow will be in this direction. Current flow through D3 D4 in this direction through R1. So thereby again R3 is bypassed. Okay, so the gain of the amplifier remains equal to minus R4 divided by R1. Minus R4 divided by R1. Very simple. Okay. Yes. So that is the the role of diodes D1 and D2. Okay. So that's explained here. So the none of the diodes is forward biased, and they have, okay, when the output amplitude is low. Okay. Now the question is, when the output amplitude is very low. Okay, guess why it is low is because, observe this, when the diode is forward biased, what is the voltage drop across the diode, guys? When let us consider this, each diode, D1 and D2, when each diodes are forward biased, let us say, for example, positive cycle, okay? When the feedback circuit gives a positive cycle, diode D1 and D2 is forward biased, each diode has a forward voltage drop of 0.7 volts. For a silicon diode, it is 0.7 volts. What is the total voltage drop? 1.4 volts. 1.4 volts. Other than that, there is a voltage drop due to output voltage across R4. Across R4, there is a voltage drop due to output voltage V0. So because of this, the effective voltage drop across the feedback network, if it is very low, if the voltage is very low, then these two diodes will be bypassed, because the reason for that is, if the output voltage is very small, these two diodes will not, these two pair of diodes, I'm sorry, I should not say two diodes, I should say two pair of diodes will not be forward biased, then the feedback path will be through R3 and R4 and R1. Yes, let me erase this part and write again. If the output voltage is very low, okay, then the feedback path is R3, R4 and R1. So R3, R4 gives R2. So the gain of the amplifier is A is equal to minus R2 by R1. Very simple, okay? Now, let us say output voltage increases, V0 increases. When V0 increases, what happens is that these diodes comes into picture. These pair of diodes comes into picture, okay? When the output amplitude is very high, okay? Then D3, D4 is bypassed. D4 resistors will bypass the R3. When output voltage is negative, then D1, D2 will bypass R3, so that the current path of the current will be R4 diodes and R1. R3 is bypassed. Output gain decreases. The gain of the amplifier decreases, because now the gain is due to resistor R4. Very simple. Yes, okay. Is that point clear, guys? So that's explained here. So thereby, the amplifier gain is minus R2 by R1, which is designed to exceed critical value of 29. Okay. So for oscillation, for oscillations to sustain, this AV should be greater than 29. It should exceed 29. Should be greater than or equal to 29. Okay. Slightly exceed means it should not be 50. It's not like that. Okay. It should be slightly greater than 29, so that the oscillation is sustained. But to control the oscillation, the method is R2 is divided into R3 and R4. So thereby we can adjust the value of the output voltage by selecting appropriate value of resistor R3 and R4. Further adjustment is possible, okay, by including a potentiometer instead of resistor R4. See, in this case, we had a resistor R4, it is a fixed resistor in this case, okay. If this is made a potentiometer and it is divided into two resistors. One is a potentiometer, R5. Another is a fixed resistor, R6. Together, it gives a resistor, R4. In this case, what will happen is, in this case, the advantage now is, by varying R5, we can control the gain. Because what is the gain? Is minus R4 divided by R1. Which is nothing but equal to minus R5 plus R6, divided by R1. Okay, so R5 is potentiometer. By varying this potentiometer, we can adjust the gain of the amplifier. By adjusting the gain of the amplifier, output voltage can be adjusted. Output voltage can be adjusted. Output voltage can be adjusted. Okay, then this is nothing but this knob of the signal generator. This knob of the signal generator, that is potentiometer. Amplitude knob of the signal generator. Okay, this amplitude knob represents this resistor R5. Okay, we are adjusting the value of this resistor R5 by using the knob. Thereby, we are adjusting the output voltage generated by the oscillator. Signal generator. Output voltage generated using the signal generator. Signal generator. So this is called as output stabilization. Okay. So further control is possible using potentiometer R5. Other part remains the same. Other R3 and D1, D2, D3, 4, D4 remains the same. This R4 is further split into two resistors. Okay. Yes. Okay. So one example is given. For example, if R4 is split into two resistors, 1 kilo ohm potentiometer and this 1.2 kilo ohm fixed resistor, further control is possible, further stabilization is possible. Okay, so that is explained here. When the output amplitude is large enough, which will forward large enough means if it is positive cycle, negative cycle, D1, D2 or D3, D4 will be forward bias. Resistor R3 is short circuited. Okay. The amplifier voltage gain now becomes is equal to minus R4 by R1. So this is designed to be too small to sustain oscillations. Okay, see, this should, if R4 is very small, output amplitude stabilization becomes zero. Output, let us say it is oscillating, then it becomes zero. If it becomes zero, then we cannot get any voltage. Okay, so we cannot get any signal. So it should not be too small to reduce the oscillation to zero. Okay. So the circuit cannot oscillate when the with the high amplitude output. Okay, however, it can be it can and does oscillate with a low amplitude output. Okay, so that means output amplitude is stabilized, it is reduced for our requirement, according to our requirement. Okay, so to design the how to, next is the design part, how to design this output stabilization circuit. The amplifier is first designed in the usual manner. So last class we saw one numerical problem. According to that, the circuit is designed. So circuit is designed means this circuit, somebody is joined now. Okay, just a second. Just hold on a second. This is it's copying, it's taking the. So output is stabilization circuit is designed in this usual manner. This is the circuit the design what we discussed in the last class. In this case, the R2 value is equal to 220 kilo. Okay, now this should be divided into two resistors, R3 and R4. This R4 should be further separated into R5 and R6. Okay, this R5 and R6 should be should be such that R5 is a potentiometer, R6 is a fixed resistor. Okay, so that is required now. That is the requirement to further stabilize the output of the amplifier or oscillator in general. Okay, yeah. So this So the design is designed. So the current I2 is used to calculate a resistor for the feedback network. Is this design we have seen? Okay, in the numerical problem we discussed with respect to current I2. Okay, so this current I2 must be large enough for the diodes to be forward biased into the near linear region of their characteristics. Okay, yes, what happens is that earlier, at least in this circuit, we didn't add any resistor, diodes. In this circuit, we didn't add any diodes. When diode comes into picture, the problem is that to forward bias this diodes, the current flowing through the diode should be large enough to forward bias the diodes. If it is very small, diode will not be forward biased. Okay, you must have seen in your ADC lab, we had that rectifier circuit using the diodes. Okay, when the current through the diode, if it is very small, diode will not be forward biased. Okay, if it is large enough, diode can be forward biased. So for that purpose, the current I2, which is considered for the design of the oscillator, this current I2 should be large enough. This current I2 should be large enough to forward bias the diodes, pair of diodes. Okay. Yes. So considering that larger current to forward bias the diodes, so resistor R1 is then calculated. So by considering larger current I2, and see for R1, the it is what is R1 guys? If you observe this, how do we get this expression? Okay. So for that we have to look into this circuit R1. What is R1 is voltage across R1 is calculated as the current flowing through R1 and the value of resistance R1. Okay, that means voltage across R1 is equal to V R1 into I2. Okay, what is this voltage? It is nothing but the input voltage. Okay, so for this oscillator circuit, this is the input voltage Vi and this is the output voltage. What is the gain of this amplifier guys? It is A. So gain is equal to V0 by Vi. Gain is equal to V0 in terms of voltage. In terms of voltage, gain is equal to V0 by Vi. So what is Vi? Vi is nothing but equal to V0 by A. V0 by A. For oscillator stabilization requirement, A should be at least 29. Okay, and as Vi is substituted as V0 divided by 29. Okay, so that's how we get this expression where V0 is equal to, Vi is equal to V0 by 25. Okay, this expression. So this somewhere here. Amplitude stabilization. I think I'm missing that somewhere here, correct. Okay. So V0 R1 is equal to V0 by 29 divided by I2. Okay, that's how we get the value of R1. R2 is using the value of voltage gain 29. So because voltage gain is equal to minus R2 by R1, minus R2 by R1. This minus does not make change the value of resistors. Okay, minus indicate it is inverting nature. That's all. Okay, so R2 is equal to 29 times R1 because it, gain should be 29 to generate the oscillations, to sustain the oscillations. R3. What is R3? Okay, so for R3, let's R3 is identified like this. Observe this. Okay, this just now we discussed. Okay, so for R3, what will happen is, what is the voltage across R3? So the voltage across R3 is the voltage across the diodes. At a time, two diodes will be forward biased, either D1, D2 or D3, D4. Okay, voltage across each diode is 0.7 volts. Total voltage is 1.4 volts, approximately 1. In other words, in general words, 2VF, where VF is the forward voltage drop of the diode, forward voltage drop of single diode. Okay, so the voltage across R3 is 2VF, and the current through the R3 is I2. Okay, so the value of R3 is equal to 2VF divided by I2. Okay, so that's how we get the value of R3. So R3 gives the from that we get the, generate the value of R3. So R3 is equal to 2VF divided by I2. So from that we can calculate the value of R4, because R2 is equal to R3 plus R4. R3 plus R4. We have found out the value of R2. We have found out the value of R3. So then we can calculate the value of R4. R4 is equal to R2 minus R3. Because why it is R2 minus R3? Because R2 is bigger than R3. Okay, because R3 is part of R2. So from this, the resultant component should give the gain as R3 plus R4 divided by R1. Okay. Slightly, this value should be slightly greater than 29. Why? Because when we are selecting these R3 and R4 values, what is the general assumption is, for all the resistor values, we should always select the smaller standard value. Values. When we select a smaller standard value for both R3 and R4, sum of this R3 and R4 will be less than R2. Okay, if R2 reduces, voltage gain will reduce. It will become less than 29 voltage gain. If it is less than 29, output will not oscillate. The oscillator amplifier will not oscillate. Okay, so thereby what is required is this R3, R4 should be such that it should result in a oscillations. Okay, should be this parameter R3 plus R4 divided by R1 should be greater than 29 for oscillations to occur. Okay, and also R4 by R1 should be less than 29. Why? Because when R3 is bypassed, when R3 becomes bypassed, so this value reduces to 0. Okay, so we are left with only R4 by R1. This R4 by R1 should be less than, it will be less than 20 because R4 is part of the R2. It is understood. So R4 by R1 should be less than 29 so that when R3 is bypassed, the gain reduces, voltage gain of the amplifier reduces, output voltage oscillations should reduce. Output voltage oscillations should reduce when R3 is bypassed. Okay. When R3 is included in the circuit, output amplitude should increase. Output should result in a saturation. Okay. Okay, now what is the selection criteria for the diodes? So diodes should be low current switching diodes, should work with the low currents. They should have reverse breakdown voltage greater than the circuit's supply voltage. Yes, what is the meaning of this? Okay, now what is reverse breakdown voltage of a diode case? When the diode is reverse biased. Okay, so let us understand here only. When the diode is reverse biased, okay, when it is forward biased, the voltage drop across the diode is 0.7 volts. Okay, when it is forward biased, when it is reverse biased, the voltage drop across the diode is the supply voltage. Whatever the voltage applied to the circuit, that supply voltage will appear across the diode. Okay, so this reverse breakdown voltage should be greater than supply voltage so that circuit does not, the diode is not damaged whenever they are reverse biased. And their reverse recovery time should be maximum of 1/10 of the time period of the oscillation frequency. Okay, that means recovery time. What is the reverse recovery time of a diode case? When it is reverse biased, the diode is open. The diode acts as a open circuit. When it is forward biased, diode acts as a closed circuit. Okay, correct. Now, when it is reverse biased, the diode is open, and when it is forward biased, diode is closed. This time period, which is called as reverse recovery time, that is time required to recover for the diode to come out of the reverse bias, should be very small. Okay, this time should be very, very small. Maximum allowable acceptable time is 1/10 of the time period of the oscillation frequency. For example, let's say the oscillator operates with a frequency of f. Time period is 1 by t. Okay, larger the frequency, time period is smaller. Correct. See, what we expect is, see, in this in this signal generator, we expect the signal generator to generate the oscillations in the range of hertz, not even kilohertz. To start with, we should say hertz, hertz to megahertz. Okay, it should operate in the range of hertz. very small frequency to maximum frequency, megahertz, okay, or gigahertz, in fact, even gigahertz, we can go up to 3.4 to 3.5 gigahertz in our laboratory signal generators. But there are some oscillators which generate oscillations even bigger than gigahertz. Okay, no problem. Okay, so if the frequency is very large, okay, for example, let us say gigahertz, okay, what will be the time period? Time period will be very, very small. That means time period is so small, this time period is very, very small. Okay, this time period will be very, very small. This is time period, okay, this is very smaller. This reverse recovery time of the diode should be very small. Maximum it should be 1/10 of this time period. Okay, that's reverse recovery time, TRR, should be 1/10 of this time period. When the frequency is very, very large, that is, in other words, in simple words, the diode should switch at a very faster rate. This reverse recovery time should be very, very small. The switching rate of the diode should be very large so that the diode can switch at a faster rate, and hence output stabilization can be achieved at a very faster rate. Very simple. That is the meaning of this. Okay, so some distortion can still occur in the output waveform. if R3 plus R4 divided by R1 is much larger than 29. Okay, as I said, this factor, you know, there is gain of the amplifier should not be too larger. As I said, okay, what is the value? It depends on the circuit, you know. We cannot fix a value. Let us say we cannot say 30, 31, okay, something like this, you know. But if it is too large, then it results in distortion. Okay. On the other hand, attempts to make R3 plus R4 less divided by R1 exactly equal to 29 may not result in a oscillation. You know? If it is exactly equal to 29, that also may not result in any oscillation. Okay. If output does not result in any oscillation, then it is of no use. We cannot call it as a oscillator. Okay. Yeah. So the problem is solved by making proper, portion of R4 adjustable as R5 and R6. Okay. Fine. This R4 is equal to R5 plus R6. Okay. R6. This is R6. Okay, R6. Now, for further smooth adjustment of R4, what is done is, this R5 is, of course, it's selected as a potentiometer. And this R5 should equal to approximately 40% of the R4. This R5 is 40% of R4. And this R6 is 80%, see, should have been 60%. So 40 plus 60, it is 100% of R4. But instead, R6 is selected as 80% of R4. That means R4 plus R6 is greater than R4 now. Why? Because R5 is 40% of R4 and R6 is 80% of R4. That means 120%. Okay. So that means it is 1.2 times R5 plus R6 is 1.2 times larger than R4. Why this is done is because to keep the gain slightly greater than 29, R4 should be slightly larger. For that purpose, R5 plus R6 is selected in such a way that R5 plus R6 will be greater than R4, R5 will be 40% of R4 and R6 is 80% of R4. This, as I said, is a trial and error method, you know. Adjustment is such a way that, you know, gain should be larger than 29. There is a slightly larger than 29. There is a main intention. Okay, this gives plus or minus 20% adjustment in R4. Smooth adjustment. Okay, yeah, here. Okay, so it's a design problem. Design phase shift oscillator to give a maximum output of plus or minus 3 volts with an oscillation frequency of 6 kilohertz. Include distortion minimization adjustment. That is diode and R4 and R5 adjustment. Okay, resistor usage. Okay, yes. Now, in the beginning, we have understood that, you know, this current I2 should be very large. This current I2 requirement is, you know, is such that I2 should be very, very large. Okay, so that very large means it should be large enough to forward bias a diode. If a diode cannot be forward bias, then we cannot make use of the diodes in the circuit. Okay, fine. Yeah. So thereby, current I2 is, current I2 is assumed to be at least 1 milliampere, so that diodes are forward biased, and the peak, when the peak output is, okay, the, when the peak, yes, I'm sorry, okay, peak to peak value is plus or minus 3 volts, okay, yes, that means to say that, yes, it is something like this. What is expected now is we should generate oscillation whose peak to peak value is plus 3 volts, and this is the output voltage V0, and minus 3 volts. Okay, this diode combination D1, D2 and D3, D4 should come into picture. That means this should be operating. Okay, there is a D1, D2 and D3 and D4. They should be operating when output voltage reaches this saturation, this peak level. Okay, when output reaches this peak level, this diode should be forward biased. Okay, if the output voltage is less than this, for example, if the output voltage is less than this, then these diodes should be bypassed. That means R3 should come into picture. Okay, so for this purpose, what is the requirement is that the current I2, which is flowing through this combination of diodes, current I2, should be large enough to forward bias these diodes when the output voltage reaches 3 volts. That means, what is the intention here is that we should be able to adjust the output voltage within plus 3 volts and minus 3 voltage range. For example, let us say I want plus 0.5 volts, 0.5 volts, I should be able to obtain, you know. And let us say I want minus 0.75 volts, for example, I should be able to adjust, you know. So using resistor R5 connection, by varying that, I should be able to obtain this, okay. So these diodes are forward biased when the output voltage reaches maximum of peak voltage of plus 3 volts and minus 3 volts. So for that, the current selection should be very large. And hence, I2 is assumed to be equal to 1 milliamperes for a maximum output voltage of 3 volts. When the output voltage reaches a maximum peak to peak value. Okay. So with I2 as 1 millivolts, what is the value of R1? V0 is 3 volts, plus or minus 3 volts, of course. Plus or minus 3 volts, it doesn't make sense. Anyway, it's oscillating, you know. Obviously, it will have both the positive cycle as well as negative cycle. Okay. We should not calculate for both the positive plus 3 as well as minus 3, not necessary. Okay. So V0 is 3 volts divided by 29 divided by 1 milliamperes. R1 gives approximate value of calculated value is 103 ohms. Okay, fine. So for 103 ohms, what is the standard value? Let us check into the standard values. Okay, so 103 ohms. So for a 103 ohms under 5% tolerance. Yes, just PDF is not responding. Yes, just hold on a second. Something is open now. Okay, yeah, under 5% tolerance. 103 ohms. Okay, so what is the value of the resistance? Is for what? 103 ohms. Okay, for 103 ohms, yeah, somewhere here. Okay, observe this. It lies somewhere here. The value of the R1 is 103 ohms. The closer value is 110 and 100. Okay, which one to select? If 110 is selected, what will happen is, what is the effect of selecting the higher resistor value? One reason is that R1 is the input resistance. You know, if you observe this circuit, R1 happens to be a input resistance, and we have understood in the beginning that, you know, input resistance should be smaller, as small as possible, better. Okay, one reason. Another reason is that if you see the equation for the R1, okay, if you see the equation for the R1, V0 is expected to be plus or minus 3 volts. If you select R1 larger, V0 also increases. But V0 is said to be only plus or minus 3 volts. Okay. So thereby, it is better to select 100 ohms rather than 110 ohms for the value of R1. 110 ohms for the value of R1. Okay. So the value selected for the value for R1 is 100 ohms. Rather than 110 ohms. Okay, so there is a reason. So standard value is 100 ohms. What about R2, guys? It's very simple. The gain should be 29, and then R2 should be 29 times R1. It is 2.9 kilo ohms. Here we should not find out the standard value. Why? Because this R2 should be divided into two resistors, R3 plus R4. This R4 should be further split into R5 plus R6. R5 plus R6. Okay. So thereby, for for R2 and R4, we should not find a standard value from the table. We should split the value, and then we have to find the standard value. Okay. Yeah. Here we go. Okay. So what about R3, guys? From this expression, 2VF divided by I2. So VF is close to 0.6 to 0.7 practically for a silicon diode. It's approximately 1.4 kilo. Since R3 is a fixed resistance, we have to find out the standard value. For 1.4 kilo ohm, the standard value is 1.4 kilo ohm. No? For the 1.4 kilo ohm, the standard value. How to select? Okay. 1.4 is a kilo ohm range. 1.4 kilo ohm. Okay. We are very close. We can select either 1.3 kilo ohms or 1.5 kilo ohms. what happens 1.3 selected and what happens if 1.5 selected. Okay, because in this case for R3 the situation is such that if 1.3 kilo ohms is selected, if R3 reduces, okay, because this numerator factor is a constant value, no problem. Okay, numerator is a constant value, but if R3 is reduced, what is the gain of the amplifier? Guys, minus R2 by R1. R2 is split into minus R3 plus R4 divided by R1. If R1 reduces, voltage gain will reduce. It will become less than 29, and hence for R3, higher standard value has to be selected. Okay, and hence though calculated value is 1.4 kilo, the 1.5 kilo is selected to maintain the gain of the amplifier at 29. Is that okay? Yes. So there is a logic, you know, that is the understanding. There is a basic principle on which resistor value has to be selected. What about R4? Yes, is very simple. R2 minus R3, 1.4 kilo ohms. For this, again, we should not find out a standard value because R4 has to be split into R5 and R6. R5 should be 40% of R4. We get it as 560 ohms. Again, it is a potentiometer. Since R5 is a potentiometer, for 560 ohms, nearest standard potentiometer is 1 kilo ohm. That you can check it in the, you know, in the standard potentiometer table. In the potentiometer, we have a 1 kilo ohm potentiometer. 500 ohms potentiometer is not sufficient, you know, because it should go up to 560 ohms. Okay, and then it's better to select 1 kilo ohm potentiometer. Okay, so for R5 potentiometer value is 1 kilo ohm. Okay, what about R6 guys? It is 80% of R4. 80% of R4 gives 1.12 kilo ohms. Again, this is a standard value. This is a, you know, what is it's a standard fixed resistor. So for that, we have to find out the standard value. For 1.12 kilo ohm, if you see the standard value, it's somewhere here, 1.12 kilo ohms. Yeah. Okay. 1.12 kilo ohm is somewhere here. 1.12 kilo ohms. Which one to select? Again, the same problem. If you select smaller value, the gain will there's a chances of gain reducing, less than, becoming less than 29. Okay. So it's better to select higher standard value, and the higher standard value is 1.2 kilo ohms. So for R6, it is 1.2 kilo ohms. So selected value is 1.2 kilo ohms. Okay, and R is equal to R1 in the circuit. You know, in the RC phase shift oscillator, the value of R is equal to R1. So from that we can select the value. C values using this expression, we get it as 0.1 microfarad, and 0.1 microfarad happens to be the standard value. From formula, we can straight away get the value of capacitor. Okay, this, what about the D1 and D2, D3, D4? This is the condition. Since it is a frequency 6 kilohertz, okay, so the time period is 1 by 6 kilohertz into 10. The reverse recovery time should be very less, and it is should be less than 16.7 microseconds. Okay, so select diode in such a way that the reverse recovery time should be smaller. It should be smaller than 16.7 microseconds. And what is the reverse breakdown voltage? It should be greater than VCC. In this case, VCC is plus or minus 15 volts. So reverse recovery, reverse breakdown voltage should be larger than the supply voltage. So we have to select the diodes D1, D2, D3, D4 such that it will have reverse recovery time smaller than 16.7 microseconds and breakdown voltage larger than 15 volts, plus or minus 15. Generally, you know, that's why the author says typically, because in most of the practical applications, you know, we make use of plus or minus 15 volts. As I said in the earlier class, the other possible supply voltage is plus or minus 12 volts. So if the diode can withstand 15 volts, definitely it can withstand 12 volts. Even some op amps are run with plus or minus 8 volts. Anyway, no problem. When it can withstand 15 volts, definitely it can also withstand 8 volts. That's all. Okay. So what is the diode? Is diode is IN914, which has a reverse recovery time of 4 nanosecond, which is less than 16.7 microseconds. It is nanoseconds, which is less than 16.7 microseconds. and VR max, there is reverse breakdown voltage, is 75 volts. It can withstand up to 75 volts. Okay, so and then so the suggested diode usage is IN914 diodes. Of course, again, guys, you know, which diode to make use of, you know, in the exam, if you get some other voltage, some other frequency, don't worry. So suggest IN914 as the diode, because in practical application, we don't apply voltage bigger than 50 volts, and reverse recovery time in terms of nanosecond is sufficient. So the most suitable diode is IN914 silicon diodes. It's okay, fine. In the next class, we'll continue with the main bridge oscillator. So with that, I think just a second. Oscillators, main bridge oscillator we have discussed. And after that, we have the comparators and converters. Okay, that is the second part of the third unit. Okay, what is the strength, guys? It is 44. I think it is relative small. Okay, anyway, thank you, guys. Thanks for joining. Okay, see you in the next class. Take care. Bye.